Hello, this is Professor Kitch. Welcome to this webcast on sections 9.8 and 9.9, which cover the concept of effective stress. When you finish this module, you should be able to describe the concept of a soil skeleton and how that relates to interparticle forces. The effective stress equation is one of the most important equations in geotechnical engineering, and you should be able to write it from memory. And you should be able to compute the vertical effective stress in both the case where the water is static and the case where there's steady state flow. We'll also revisit the concept of the coefficient of lateral earth pressure in this section, and when you completed the section, you should be able to not only define K, but also use it to compute horizontal effective stress. You should be able to draw more circles for both the total and effective stresses at a point. And finally, you should be able to compute the pore pressure, not only below the groundwater table, but also within the capillary fringe. As we know, soil is a particulate material made up of solid particles in void space. When a stress is applied to the soil, part of that stress is transmitted through the solid particles and their particle-to-particle contacts. If the void space is filled with water, part of that stress is carried through the pore pressure. If we zoom into a place where two particles come into contact, we can see that the interparticle stress is carried through particle-to-particle contact, and that the pore pressure acts to push the two particles apart. The term soil skeleton refers to the arrangement of solid particles in the soil and their interconnections. Stresses are transferred from particle to particle through these interparticle contacts. In a saturated soil, pore water fills all the voids. The pore pressure is the same in all directions and therefore acts normal to the surfaces of the solid particles. For this reason, the pore pressure tends to reduce the interparticle stresses. Let's take a close look at the contact area between two soil particles. There will be some total normal stress, sigma t, being transmitted at the contact boundary. That stress will consist of the weight of the material from the tributary area above this contact point, W, divided by the contact area, A. The pore water pressure, U, acts normal to the particle surface in opposition to this total stress. The rest of the total stress is transferred across a particle boundary as interparticle stress, sigma c. So sigma c is that stress carried by the soil skeleton through interparticle contact. And the total stress, sigma t, is the sum of the interparticle stress, sigma c, and the pore water pressure, U. Or we can rewrite the equations as sigma c is equal to the total stress minus the pore water pressure. This division of the total stress into the portion carried by pore pressure and the portion carried by the soil skeleton through the interparticle contacts is at the heart of the concept of effective stress. The effective stress is that portion carried by the soil skeleton, here represented by sigma c, the interparticle stress. As we'll see in a moment, the effective stress isn't exactly equal to sigma c, but conceptually they're the same. Now the interparticle contact transfers both shear stress and normal stress, so let's take a close look at how the pore water pressure affects these two components of stress. If sigma t and tau are applied at the top of the interface, there must be an equal and opposite sigma t and tau at the bottom of the interface. We know that there's a pore pressure U acting normal to the contact and carrying part of the total stress, thereby reducing the stress which is carried across the contact, sigma c. However, the shear stress acts normal to the contact surface and therefore normal to the pore pressure. Therefore, the shear stress is not affected by the pore pressure and the full shear stress is transferred across the interparticle contact. So pore pressure affects normal stresses within a soil skeleton, but not the shear stresses. So now let's expand our discussion from contact stress to the concept of effective stress. And let's define the relationships among total stress, pore pressure, and effective stress. We'll consider a point A below the groundwater table where the soil is saturated. As we just discussed, the total stress at A is carried partly by the soil skeleton through interparticle contact stresses and partly through the water by pore pressure. We previously defined the interparticle stress sigma sub C based on the contact area between particles. While this definition was helpful for understanding how stresses are carried by the soil skeleton, it's not a useful formulation to use in practice because it's not possible to know the area of all the interparticle contacts in a volume of soil. Instead, we are going to define the vertical effective stress, sigma prime z, as the total stress, sigma z, minus the pore pressure, u. The effective stress, sigma prime z, is still that portion of the stress that is carried by the soil skeleton. But instead of defining the stress based on the area of the particle contacts, as we did with sigma prime c, we define it using the entire cross-sectional area of the soil element. We do this for two reasons. First, it makes the effective stress easy to compute, and second, it works. So this is the equation we will use to define the effective stress. We'll use the notation sigma prime to denote effective stresses and sigma to denote total stress. And the effective stress will always be the total stress minus the pore water pressure. In this equation, we've dropped the subscript z because the definition applies in any direction, vertical, horizontal, or otherwise. Note that the concept of effective stress applies only to normal stresses and not shear stresses. As we discussed earlier, the pore pressure always acts normal to the shear stresses and therefore doesn't affect them. So when we're discussing total and effective stresses, we're always talking about normal stresses. So now let's compute the effective stress at A in this example. To do this, we'll assume A is at a depth z below the ground surface and a depth zw below the groundwater table. And we'll also assume that our soil has a unit weight of gamma 1 above the groundwater table and gamma 2 below the groundwater table. If the groundwater is static and we install a piezometer at A, the water in the piezometer will rise up to the groundwater table. From our previous module on geostatic stress, we know that the total vertical stress at A is the integral of gamma dz from 0 to z. Or for uniform soil layers, the summation of gamma sub I, h sub I. So, the total vertical stress at point A is gamma 1 times the quantity z minus zw plus gamma 2 times zw. The pore pressure at A will simply be gamma water times the height of the water in the piezometer, which is zw. And then we can compute the effective stress at A, that is sigma prime z, as sigma total minus u. And for this example, that will be gamma 1 times the quantity z minus zw plus gamma 2 zw minus gamma water times zw. If we want, we can simplify the equation by combining these last two terms, and we'll have that the effective vertical stress at A, sigma prime z, is gamma 1 times z minus zw minus the quantity gamma 2 minus gamma w times zw. So this equation, stating that the effective stress is equal to the total stress minus the pore water pressure, is perhaps the single most important concept in all of geotechnical engineering, and one you should commit to memory. We learned in an earlier section that we generally computed the horizontal stress using the coefficient of lateral earth pressure. Now that we've developed the concept of effective stress, we need to revisit that concept of lateral earth pressure and treat it more thoroughly. We stated earlier that the coefficient of lateral earth pressure was the ratio of the horizontal normal stress to the vertical normal stress. Now we need to be more specific. We will define the coefficient of lateral earth pressure, K, as the ratio of the effective horizontal stress to the effective vertical stress, or sigma prime x over sigma prime z. Or we can write that sigma prime x is equal to k times sigma prime z. So our procedure to compute the horizontal effective stress is to compute the vertical effect of stress sigma prime z as sigma z minus the pore pressure u. Then determine K from load history and geologic effects. This will be covered more completely in chapter 17. Then compute the effect of horizontal stress sigma prime x as K times sigma prime z. The total horizontal stress sigma x is then computed as sigma prime x plus u. Notice that we cannot compute the total horizontal stress directly from the total vertical stress. We must first compute the effective stresses and then add the pore pressure back in to get the total stresses. This is because we define the coefficient of lateral earth pressure in terms of effective stresses rather than total stresses. An interesting and sometimes counterintuitive thing happens above the groundwater table, so let's take a minute or two to look at that. Below the groundwater table, or phreatic surface, the soil is saturated and the pore pressure is equal to gamma water times ZW. ZW is positive, so U is positive. The effective vertical stress is equal to the total vertical stress minus the pore pressure U. And since U is positive, the effective vertical stress will always be less than the total vertical stress. Now, as we learned in chapter 7, above the phreatic surface there is a zone of capillary rise where the soil remains saturated. In this zone, the pore pressure U is equal to gamma water times ZW. However, in this zone, above the free water surface, ZW is negative, and therefore the pore pressure is also negative. The fundamental equation for effective stress still applies. The effective stress is equal to the total stress minus the pore pressure. However, in this zone, the pore pressure is negative, and we'll be subtracting a negative value from the total stress sigma z. Therefore, within the zone of capillary rise, the effective stress will actually be greater than the total stress. This is due to the negative pore water pressure in this zone. Above the zone of capillary rise, the soil becomes unsaturated. In this zone, the pore water pressure is no longer equal to ZW times gamma water. We have to use unsaturated soil mechanics in this zone to describe the soil behavior, a topic which is beyond the scope of this course. Let's quickly look at how Mohr circles compare between total and effective stresses. Assume we have determined this to be the Mohr circle for some point in the ground based on total stress. And let's assume that that point is below the groundwater table with a positive pore pressure. Recalling our equation for effective stress, sigma prime is equal to sigma minus u, we know that the pore pressure u acts in all directions, so all normal stress will be reduced by the same value of u when computing the effective stress. This is regardless of the orientation of the normal stress. We also know that the pore pressure does not affect shear stresses. That means that the positive pore pressure will have the effect of shifting the entire Mohr circle to the left without changing the size of the circle. And the magnitude of that shift will be equal to the positive pore pressure u. Now, if we're in a situation where the pore pressure is negative, such as in the capillary zone above the groundwater table, then the effective stresses will be greater than the total stresses and have the effect of shifting the Mohr circle to the right by the amount of the negative pore pressure u. For our final topic in this section, let's compute the effective stress for cases where we have steady state flow, such as under this concrete dam shown. Now, section 9.9 of your text describes the concept of seepage forces and how they affect total and effective stresses. While this concept is correct and a valid way to compute the effective stress under steady state flow, I find it confusing, and I think there's a much simpler way to compute effective stresses under steady state flow. So let's look at this flow net, which you analyzed back in Chapter 8. And we'll look just at point A, though this method would apply for any location within the flow net. The depth to A is Z, and the depth of water ponded behind the dam is HW. Now, we've installed a piezometer at point A, and we know from flow net theory that the height of the water rises in the piezometer, ZW, is less than the total height to the tailwater, Z plus HW. That's because water is flowing in this dam from upstream to downstream. So now that we have a piezometer installed at point A, all we have to do is use the equation for effective stress, sigma prime is equal to sigma minus u, to compute the effective stress at A. First, we compute the total stress at A. The total vertical stress is the summation of gamma times h, which in this case is hw times gamma water, plus gamma times z. The pore pressure at A is the height the water is rising in the piezometer at that point, zw, times gamma water. That is exactly the same way we compute pore pressure from the static condition. The effective vertical stress is simply sigma z minus u, or hw times gamma water plus gamma times z minus zw times gamma water. Notice that we didn't even discuss the topic of seepage forces. This procedure is really no different than that used to compute effective stress under static groundwater conditions. So this is Kitch's rule for computing effective stresses at any point under the ground. Stick a piezometer at the location you're interested in and find out how high the water rises in that piezometer. The pore pressure will be equal to gamma water times the height of the water rise in the piezometer. Compute the total vertical stress as the summation of gamma times z, then compute the effective stress as the total stress minus the pore pressure. Keep it simple and stick to the fundamentals. So let's review. Total stress is divided into effective stress, which is that portion carried by the soil skeleton, and pore pressure, which is carried by the pore water. The fundamental equation is the effective stress is equal to the total stress minus the pore water pressure. Memorize it. The coefficient of lateral earth pressure is the ratio of effective horizontal stress to effective vertical stress, and we compute the effective horizontal stress as K times the effective vertical stress. Pore pressure affects normal stresses, but not shear stresses. In the saturated capillary zone above the groundwater table, the pore pressure is negative. All the fundamental equations apply. You just need to make sure you properly compute the pore pressure. And use Kitch's rule to compute the effective stress under steady state flow conditions. Stick a piezometer in, compute the pore pressure from the height of the water in the piezometer, then compute the effective stress as sigma minus u. Finally, here's a deceivingly simple practice problem for you. Try to complete it before class. That's all.